What if we are being watched by godlike aliens? Looking up at the night sky and its beauty can be baffling and an intriguing experience for many. But aside from this beauty, there can be something scary out there. Or maybe not scary. As Arthur C. Clarke said, we are either alone in this universe or we are not. And both these ideas are equally scary. But today we are going to talk about the former one. Yes, we are talking about aliens, but in a totally different context. What if we are being watched by aliens, or in fact a godlike alien civilization? Are they just watching us like we watch animals in a zoo? We've seen and read a lot of sci-fi movies and novels which show that we live in a simulation, or we are some kind of experiment, not knowingly, and there is someone watching and observing us. But the word zoo has a certain significance which we can relate to. Today, the animal zoos have to keep animals caged so that we can observe them and, more importantly, go on a summer evening and just watch them with some snacks. What if we are the same animals for a godlike alien civilization? The thought itself is terrifying for a lot of people. So today in this video, we will talk about the possibility of what if we are being watched by aliens. Also, we have already made a video on the Fermi Paradox and why we haven't seen any aliens. Make sure to watch that video too. Recently, there has been a lot of hype about UFOs and aliens, and on June 25th, 2021, the Pentagon released its much-awaited report on extraterrestrial life. The idea that we have a special place in the universe was first challenged by Copernicus in the 16th century. Since then, scientists have built upon that idea and ripped apart every possibility of us having a special place in this universe. We know that we, along with seven other planets and other dwarf planets, asteroids and comets, orbit a medium-sized star, which is just a fairly ordinary star in an ordinary galaxy. The universe is very vast and has billions of galaxies. These billions of galaxies have trillions and trillions of planets, and many among them are habitable too. So where are they? Shouldn't the universe be teeming with spaceships? Well, that is the Fermi Paradox. Since the Copernican Revolution, two questions have eluded humanity for years. Is life typical, or is intelligence typical? Life on Earth formed and evolved in the harshest of conditions, and since we don't have a special place in this universe, life might exist outside Earth. In fact, Jupiter's moon Europa is the greatest contender of microbial life in our solar system itself. But the question is, can we find intelligent life? The Search for Extraterrestrial Life, abbreviated as SETI, is an organization that looks for life in outer space. Of all the 4,000 exoplanets observed, the vast majority have been detected using just one technique, the transit method. This is the most used method to detect extrasolar planets because it's so darn simple. The simple idea behind the transit method is you keep taking photos of a star and see if there is a dip in its brightness. So if an exoplanet around that star has a right orbital alignment, it will sometimes pass in front of the star, thereby blocking out some of the star's light. Based on the magnitude of dip in brightness, we can then infer the size of the planet, its orbits, its moons, and even its atmospheric chemistry. So why is it important in this discussion? Where do the aliens come in? Well, if we are able to observe thousands of planets using this method, then an alien civilization could be watching us via a transit method. Any star which is lined up with our ecliptic will most certainly see Earth transiting for about 13 hours every 365 days. And this is just one particular part of the sky. But that doesn't necessarily mean that we can see them transit and they can see us transit. The transit possibility of an Earth-like planet in front of a Sun-like star is 1 in 200. Following the math after this, we come to a conclusion that only 1 in 40,000 stars around us have just the right configuration for a reciprocal transit, which means we see them transit and they see us transit. It's confusing, right? But just hang on for a minute. This observation begs a question. How many of these Earth-like reciprocal transits might be out there? The answer comes out to be roughly 1,000 stars that can directly observe us transiting, and we too can see them transiting. There might obviously be other planets that might be able to see us transiting, but we cannot see them back. but in this video, we will only talk about the ones we can't see back. So let's remember this number because we will come back to it again later. Before we go to the concept of living in a zoo, which we discussed briefly in the beginning, you guys might be wondering what a godlike alien civilization is. Based on the Kardashev scale, civilizations are of three types. We have dedicated a video to the Kardashev scale and its significance, so we suggest you watch that video too to get a good insight on civilizations and their existence. But in simple words, a Type 1 civilization is the one that has consumed all the natural resources and energy of its planets. Just so you know, we are at 0.75 at that scale. A Type 2 civilization is one that has used all its energy of its host star, like the concept of a Dyson sphere. A Type 3 civilization is one that has colonized and used all the natural resources of its galaxy and will be godlike to us. And if this godlike civilization is watching us, what is their purpose? Are they responsible for life on Earth? Why aren't they making contact with us? It could be that they are observing us, and once we reach a certain level of intelligence, then they may make contact with us. We might be in a tightly regulated galaxy, and our Earth is treated like part of a vast and protected national park. This is known as the zoo hypothesis. As said earlier, the zoo word has a certain significance because we can relate to the zoo animals that we see and enjoy with popcorn on a sunny evening. And if that's the case, we are the zebras and gorillas that these aliens might be observing. The idea itself might not sit well with most people. The notion that we are just being observed by aliens as animals in a zoo goes way back in science fiction. Or it could be that we were put here by those aliens, like we put the animals in the zoo to observe them. Whether or not these aliens will reveal themselves to us is also a mystery. So if we were living in a galactic zoo, it would be pretty much quiet. It would be something like going out and observing animals in a zoo. Just like in a zoo, we observe zebras and then we move on to the other animals. The animals talk or communicate among themselves, and we just see and enjoy them doing their own animal stuff. The aliens, in the same way, might be observing us doing our weird human things that we do. But what if we could tweak this scenario a little bit to actually establish interspecies communication? That's the main purpose of SETI and a new project called METI, Messaging Extraterrestrial Intelligence, where they actively send messages of their own trying to make contact. And if we are able to conclude or assume that we live in a galactic zoo, the next obvious question would be, who are the zookeepers? Our Milky Way is about 13 billion years old. Initially, it was not suitable for habitation, but after 2 to 3 billion years, conditions were hospitable for civilizations to exist. Our planet is about 4.54 billion years old, and many civilizations could have existed before us. And if these civilizations are way older than us, they will be godlike to us and can be our zookeepers. They might be observing us almost like we observe animals in a zoo. Now, in order to make contact with them, we need to be able to see them. That's where the number of reciprocal transits that we discussed before come in. At first, making contact with a godlike alien civilization might seem like a pessimistic scenario. If they are already watching and observing us, and decided not to make contact when we are the animals in a zoo. But then again, let's imagine we go to a zoo and we are the zookeepers. But then all of a sudden, if a zebra, instead of chumming around with others, comes towards us and looks us straight in the eyes and starts counting out a series of numbers that are tough, that would establish an entirely different kind of relationship between us and the zebra. Now, we wouldn't be interested in the giraffe or the lions. We would try to understand what in the world the zebra actually wants to say and is reaching out to us. This is the exact goal that we should have instead of just sitting and waiting for them to make first contact. In fact, there may be some civilizations that are sending us messages and we haven't received them yet, but it may be for some civilizations we need to make the first contact. If we take the example of TRAPPIST-1, which is just 40 light years away from us, it has potentially three planets at a habitable distance, which we call as the Goldilocks zone. This is why it's a subject of research and curiosity for scientists. But if in case we don't want to be seen by these reciprocal transiting planets, we can sort of cloak our entire planetary signature or our biosignatures using a laser cloaking system. It might be a possibility that the other civilizations might have cloaked themselves if they are paranoid. But if they haven't cloaked themselves, then we can make first contact with them. It might be that the alien civilization is able to observe us and has chosen to not make contact because they are hyper-intelligent, and we might not be that interesting to them. We might just be like animals in a zoo that they don't care about. So what's going to prompt them to care and to reply? The thought of making contact with such advanced civilizations might seem intimidating to some, because a hyper-intelligent civilization wouldn't have anything to gain from us. Their scientific technologies and understanding of science might be a million times better than us. What will we have to teach them? Normally, when we meet a stranger, we try to emphasize our intelligence and power. But as compared to a million-years-old civilization, we don't have any of that. In fact, we should try to do the opposite and learn as much as we can. We can learn how we as individuals and as a civilization survive problems like nuclear wars and climate change. For a civilization that has been around for a million years, that problem will have been solved. They have lived for a million years. They might live another million years. But for us, that's not the case. We still face the problems of extinction through man-made or natural disasters. So with a lot of open questions, that's pretty much it for this video. Let us know what thoughts you have about being watched and making contact with a hyper-intelligent civilization in the comment section below. Make sure to like the video and subscribe to our channel so that we keep bringing some mind-boggling videos like this for you.